West. Now, he's burst onto the political scene, and Missouri GOP Senate candidate Mark McCloskey joins us here. Then, former CEO, current author Greg Graves on employee ownership, his book, and his thoughts on the economy, inflation, and more. All now on 4-Star Politics.
And we welcome you to this edition of 4-Star Politics. John Holt of Fox 4, Dave Helling of the Kansas City Star. And Dave, we continue our visit with Missouri U.S. Senate candidates here on 4-Star on the Republican side right now.
That's right. We talked with Billy Long, a congressman, and now Mark McCloskey, the well-known attorney from St. Louis, who indeed, as you pointed out, John, made a name for himself about 2 years ago in an unexpected way, right, Mark?
Yeah, well, the name was made for me, I might add. You know, that was completely unintentional. But, you know, people forget it's been a couple of years, but on the night of June 1st, June 2nd of 2020, city of St. Louis was burned. Four police officers were shot. Retired police captain David Doran was murdered in a secondary employment in a pawn shop about a half a mile from my house. And as the month of June progressed, more and more of the businesses got trashed and looted and broken into. And we watched the progression. I live in the Central West End in St. Louis. My law firm, my building, is about three blocks further into the city. And we saw the destruction just coming out further and further. And we saw more and more of the local businesses boarded up and looted. And we just made a decision that if it came our direction, we just weren't going to let it happen sitting down.
Do you regret that now, though? Do you regret taking that action, Mark, given all the things that have happened since then, the discipline that you faced at the bar, and more broadly, since you're running for the Senate, is it a plus or a minus for you?
You know, the only thing I wish I'd done, I wish I'd had the foresight to keep them from breaking down the gate and coming in. But no, I wouldn't have done anything differently under the circumstances. The reason why cancel culture works, the reason why the voluntary censorship of America works, is that everybody's afraid to take a stand for their rights. If I had been the managing partner of the biggest law firm in St. Louis on that Sunday night, the next Monday morning I would have had to go on the apology tour, apologize for being born, apologize for being white, apologize for being successful, and I'd still get fired and I would still not have another job. The only reason why we were able to do what we did is that we're not subject to intimidation. We don't have anybody that we owe any responsibility to other than ourselves and the American people. And we just, we haven't backed down. We haven't apologized for anything, and I never will.
Mark, let's talk about the campaign. As I said, you burst onto the scene, deciding to run for the U.S. Senate. Let's take a look at the numbers of our Emerson, Fox 4, and The Hill poll. And you poll at just under 4%. Eric Greitens continues to lead the pack. However, you said this recently on the public radio in St. Louis, and actually shared this with us in the green room. If you learn this guy, Mark McCloskey, running for Senate, is the pink shirt guy at the front of his porch with an AR-15, I'm in a dead heat for the lead. You have some polling, I take it, that shows that. How do you broaden that to make it statewide?
Well, you know, that's the challenge right now. We've got, 46, 47 days till the election. And so what we're doing is we're doing what we have been doing for the last 55 weeks, and that's doing old-fashioned retail politics, going every place we can, meeting as many people as possible. We're going to start a radio campaign starting on Monday in all the major markets in the state, letting people know that I am that pink shirt guy. And, it's been a fundraising challenge because of the polls like you just demonstrated, but to the extent that we can, we're going to do television. For example, this is a good opportunity.
Now, let me ask you this. Obviously, you've positioned yourself as a conservative. I've seen some of your tweets and statements. Are you working the Trump Mar-a-Lago for a Trump endorsement? We know that a couple of other candidates are.
We are certainly attempting to get Trump's endorsement. We've been told by people that know that Trump has stated that he will, in fact, endorse in this campaign. I know there's some candidates, maybe about 3 months ago, Billy Long said he came back from Mar-a-Lago and Trump told him there's two people that he's not going to endorse. And I called up Billy and I said, well, I don't want to know who those two people are as long as I'm not one of them. And he said, don't worry about it, you're not one of them. So, you know, we're still in the race for that.
But endorsements aside, Mark, how are Republicans, in your view, supposed to make the decision in August among all of these candidates? What is the key difference between Mark McCloskey and Eric Greitens and Eric Schmidt and Vicky Hartzler and Billy Long? You're all obviously on the sort of the Trumpist wing of the Republican Party. How do people make that decision as far as you're concerned?
Well, sure, and everybody running as a Republican for virtually every office in this country is all on the same side of most of the issues, right? We're all pro-life.
Right.
We're all, for energy independence and for reducing inflation and closing the border and making our military, you know, respected and feared around the world.
And but opposing gun regulations and some of the other things.
Absolutely. Obviously. So the thing that, makes a distinguishment is that I've never been a politician. I'm not beholden to anybody. I mean, the bottom line is you got Vicki Hartzler, who's been a congresswoman for 12 years. You got Billy Long, who's been a congressman for 10 years. You got Eric Greitens, who's been in politics for 17 years. Vicki Hartzler has been in politics since 1994. And Dave Schatz has been in politics for two decades. The bottom line is that I'm not beholden to anybody. You know, Einstein's definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. And so I always say that if you like the current crisis the government's in, if you like the current situation in the United States, then vote for the establishment candidate, vote for the standard politician, because they're the people that got us here.
Yeah, but that's an argument you could make for the Democrats in the race too, couldn't you, Mark? I mean, they have no prior political experience if that's how people are to make this decision.
Well, the distinction there is it is the decision where towards going more towards what Joe Biden said on March 21st of this year is that new world order. So vote for a Democrat. If you want to live in a single world socialist government, then vote for a Democrat. If you want to have independent freedom, if you respect the Constitution, if you respect our God-given rights, then your only choice is a Republican. And then if your choices are between Republicans, like the fellow that I'm going to replace that votes along with the Democrats on a lot of issues, or if you want a Republican who's going to stand up for the Constitution.
You're talking about Roy Blunt.
Yeah, I'm talking about Roy Blunt. Right. You know, he's voted, or at least said he's going to support the framework on gun control. He voted for the extending the Defense of Women Act that contained a significant red flag law. If you want to have real change, you got to vote for somebody who's not a traditional politician, who's not a go-along, get-along kind of guy, and a guy who's already demonstrated his willingness to stand up against the mob, even at the risk of his life, his career, his livelihood, stand up for the rights and stand up for the people of this country.
Mark McCloskey is our guest here on 4-Star Politics. We'll continue our conversation here. 4-Star Politics, stay with me. We're back on 4-Star Politics with Missouri Senate candidate, the Republican side, Mark McCloskey out of St. Louis. Mark, let's talk issues. Abortion, for one, you've made it very clear you oppose abortion. You're pro-life, no exceptions. Mm-hmm. Would you prefer, should Roe v. Wade be overturned, should the Alito opinion stand, do you prefer a federal law that would set the tone, or does it go back to the states? Is it your preference to go back to the states pre-Roe?
We have this little thing called the 10th Amendment to the United States Constitution that says that any powers not expressly granted to the federal government should be reserved to the states and to the people. There's no reason why the federal government should be involved in abortion law.
So no blanket federal law in your view?
I'm not a big fan of blanket federal laws on just about any topic, and certainly not on that. I think it should be left up to the people of the states to decide what their rights should be.
Would you vote to elect Mitch McConnell as majority leader if the Republicans take control of the Senate?
Absolutely,
Mark?
Absolutely not.
Why?
Well, because I think that...
And who's your alternative? I mean, obviously there's got to be someone else in the ranks that you would support.
You know, I like real conservatives. I like people that respect the Constitution.
Such as?
Rand Paul, for example. Mike Lee, for example.
Josh Hawley, for example. He, of course, endorsed Vicki Hartzler in this.
Yeah, and but they have the same general consultant, so you got to always take that into consideration. And that's one of the reasons why you got to be a little suspicious of these things. Ted Cruz endorses Eric Schmidt. Guess what? They've got the same political consultant. So that's. And I'll tell you something else. We were down at CPAC, and one of the conservative networks was interviewing Eric Schmidt about the same question, whether or not he would vote for Mitch McConnell. And he says, well, you know, that's hypothetical, blah, blah, blah. They pressed him on it, and he finally answered, and he said, I'll have to wait and see. I'll have to consult with my Senate colleagues like Rand Paul and Ted Cruz. In other words, nobody's told him the party line yet, and he didn't know the answer. Vicki Hartzler, when asked that question, had the exact same answer. And so that's the problem. That's the Mitch McConnell problem. People that don't have an independent thought, people that don't have a real political philosophy of protecting the freedom of the American people, that are go-along, get-along guys that have been here too long. And the problem with Mitch McConnell is when the left says, let's have this extreme leftist position, Mitch McConnell says, okay, let's meet in the middle over here. And then the bar gets moved over there, and Mitch comes over here further. And that's why he has to go.
We have about 30 seconds left, Mark. If you are not the nominee, will you support whoever is the nominee on the GOP side?
With a high probability, with one possible exception.
And that would be?
I don't think I could vote for Eric Greitens. I think he's a reprehensible human being.
Even if power, the balance of power in the Senate hung on that?
The rhino that you trust is more dangerous than the Democrat that you fear.
Quickly, has anyone asked you to get out of the race?
No.
No one has approached you and said, hey, you could be a spoiler. Would you consider dropping out before August 7th?
No one has asked me that question, but I suspect they know the answer.
And the answer would be?
Hell no.
And that is it. That's the final word, or two words, from Mark McCloskey, one of the GOP candidates for Senate. Mark, thanks for coming in.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Best of luck on the campaign.
Thank you very much.
Welcome back to Four Star Politics as we shift gears and welcome back a friend of the program. Former CEO at Burns & Mac turned best-selling author Greg Graves is with us. Create Amazing. Tell us about the book. How's it going? It's available on Amazon.
Tell us if you're running for the Senate, by the way, so we get that out of the way.
Not in Missouri.
Or Kansas, for that matter, as far as we know.
Actually, I'm chairing Jerry Moran's campaign.
Oh, well.
So I'm very excited, but he and I are very close.
Tell Jerry to come on this program.
He should.
We'd love to have him on.
He should. He might be afraid of one of you. Not sure which one. The book's going great. I actually think that this June right now will be the second best month for sales in the history of the book. It's been out 14 months. So the first month was obviously the best month, but it's still selling, and it's going to sell more books this month than any other since the first. We're headed towards 10,000 total copies sold, but the really what I meant for this book to do is make a difference, and it is, and I'm very excited about it. I'm working with three or four different companies that want to become employee-owned. I'm working with dozens of employee-owned companies to how can they improve their culture, be a best place to work, be more successful. And my price is always right. It's always free. So I keep getting asked a lot.
You're bringing the business model that you had at Burns and McDonald, the engineering firm in Kansas City when you were CEO, and that is employee stock ownership. Explain how you believe that can, you talk about recently in a Star guest column about how that can reduce wealth inequality.
And of course, Burns & McDonald is not just employee owned, it's 100%
right.
Employee owned. They have no one to rely on for their success other than themselves. And if you look back to the very beginnings of America, it's what made our economy boom. It's how we became the biggest economy in the world in less than 100 years from breaking off from Great Britain. It is an absolute fact that wealth disparity in America, or some say economic injustice, is at its worst point since we threw the tea off the British boats. And capitalism will not survive in that manner. Now, employee ownership is capitalism on steroids. It doesn't look for another form of economy, but what it says is when you make the individual responsible, but then give them the rewards for their success, they'll work even harder. But it's the American dream come true.
Are you whistling a little bit against the wind, Greg, in terms of the way that employees now look in this job market at their employers? You're seeing unionization efforts everywhere, Starbucks, Amazon, demands for higher wages, more time off. I mean, does your argument break through in this environment?
Actually, more unions are coming around to the fact that why can't a union employee still be an owner of its firm? It goes back to Sears and Lowe's and all of these companies that said, if we give them a piece of the pie, they'll work harder. And who deserves a piece of the pie more than them? Employee ownership in America is not slowing, it's growing. Its importance is more than it has ever been. But to the point, Dave, It's not just the employee who has to recognize I'm an owner, now I should work harder. It's the company's responsibility.
Correct.
To recognize these people aren't just employees, they're my boss.
And there is resistance at that level, isn't there, Greg? I mean, isn't that the bigger problem? It's not that employees don't want to own part of the place where they work. It's the employers who are saying, no, we need to, you know, squeeze every dollar we can for profit or something like that.
Yeah, the average company that doesn't want to become employee-owned is owned by somebody who's rich and doesn't want to give it up, which means they're in it for all the wrong reasons. And what's been discovered time and time again, and what research at the Rutgers School of Business has proven time and time again, is if you do give it up, you'll become even more wealthy, you'll become even more successful. It's a proven commodity from the Thomas Jefferson fishing boats in the 1700s to today.
I want to switch gears and draw on your expertise as a CEO. Let's talk about the economy. That's on everyone's mind.
Yeah.
Inflation, every time you pull up to the gas pump, go down the grocery store aisle. CEOs were consulted recently, a survey, the Conference Board survey of CEOs out this week shows that they expect inflation will eventually go down, but a mild recession will take place. The majority do at 57%. 11% inflation will go down. We could be facing a tough recession ahead. So 68% surveyed believe a recession is on the way. Two-part question. Did the Fed wait too long here? And do you see a recession on the horizon?
I don't. But one of the things I've always known is some of the smartest people in the world work at the Federal Reserve Bank. Look right here in Kansas City, who ran our Federal Reserve Bank, Tom Hoenig, for years and years. And I was on his interest rate committee. They're really, really brilliant people who know their job is to tame inflation but not slow the economy too much. The problem is this is really hard calculus that they have to do at the Federal Reserve Bank, not to make one mistake or another. I actually look at things pretty positively right now. Unemployment is below 4%. We'd never go into recession in those situations. The bank backlog on loans is as good as it's ever been. We almost never go into recession at those kinds of times. Everybody wants to hire. So the Federal Reserve's job is to make a few developers and a few companies put their pencils down, but not all the developers and all the companies put their pencils down. So they're not going to get it exactly right. But inflation may have peaked in April. And I always say that the Federal Reserve has to first make sure that the people who are hurt most regressively by inflation, because inflation always starts with an egg or a gallon of gas, right? That doesn't impact Deanne and I, but it impacts some people severely. And so they have to do everything they can. They came out with a big bullet this week.
Right.
And I'll have a hard time imagining.
Just quickly, you don't want to go from 3.6 unemployment to 8.6. I mean, that's the classic way of curing inflation is more unemployment.
Yeah, you don't want to stop, right? Still in America today, there's more people looking for people than there are people looking for
jobs.
Which
adds to pressure on
wages. And so if that could get right-sized, it will actually help the inflation numbers. And so I'm not overly optimistic, but I'm definitely optimistic.
Well, as we head to the break, I'm glad you have some optimism.
Because
a lot of your fellow CEOs do not. We'll continue with Greg Graves here on 4-Star Politics. We're back here on 4-Star Politics with Greg Graves, former Burns & McDonnell CEO turned author. You mentioned earlier in our chat that you're heading up Jerry Moran's campaign, Republican Senate candidate in Kansas, the incumbent. Is the era of Jerry Moran's a moderate over in politics in this country?
I'm definitely not running it, but I am his chair.
Chair.
Right, if you will. Okay. That means you help raise money and help talk about it.
A lot of times that's running it.
A little bit. It seems like in either party in America, it seems more and more that to capture that middle, I have to capture the people who will vote in the primary, which means I have to go even further right or further left. And I don't personally believe that almost any of these candidates are as far right as they have to act or as far left as they have to proclaim. We need to get back to an America where the people who represent the bulk of us who are somewhere between here on the right or here on the left are the people who represent us. And currently with the American idea of 25-20% of the people showing up for the primary, it just isn't a winning strategy.
30 seconds quickly. The World Cup coming to Kansas City, you must have been floored like everyone else with that.
I wasn't floored, but oh my, right? Kansas City is on such a roll, and it's time for the country to recognize it. That we might be in two states and a whole bunch of cities and governments, but we are this town of great individual people. And so the draft is coming and the World Cup is coming. And we might not be 10 million folks, but we will put on a hell of a party.
I'm looking forward to it, and we'll have you back to talk more about that at some point. Greg Graves.
Kathy Nelson. huge
she
champion of our
town. She sat in that very
town.
Chair not
been
a month ago.
She's we'll an absolute
get her back
stud.
Too. Greg Graves, thank you, sir. Come again. We appreciate you joining us today.
Thanks for having me, guys.
And that's another edition of 4-Star Politics. If you joined in progress, catch it at fox4kc.com on demand. Have a great week. See you next week. 4-Star Politics.